GGR Martin's Song of Ice and Fire, there seems to be a massive emphasis on magical and mythical creatures.
Many contemporary issues regarding humanity's cruelty and collective ignorance, disregard of human life is perhaps most predominant in the gradual extinction of common creatures in Westeros.
Creatures we don't particularly associate with, such as direwolves and mammoths, and of course giants and children of the forest.
It seems as if the population of each once dominant beast, such as the mammoths and direwolves, is becoming ever more reduced.
And the sadness that one possesses derives from the overpopulation and warring of humanity. Perhaps even the frozen creatures beyond the wall, the White Walkers, share this common anxiety towards humanity. Although that aggression comes from a global warming derived from the rebirth of magics and dragons, I propose that George R. R. Martin is drawing a similarity to the giants and the Neanderthals and the children and some sort of benevolent species.
Neanderthals represent the beginning of the species Homo sapiens.
Even though Neanderthals never came close to a medieval culture, like the one we see in Game of Thrones, there's definite similarities between these mythical creatures and their old rival human species. Giants share a lot in common with Homo sapiens genetically. They walk on two legs, they are as intelligent as men, perhaps in a different manner. They wear hide and speak in the old tongue, a language they shared with the first men.
The question is, who invented it?
I suspect that due to giants' large size and physical dominance over humans, they would not be interested in learning the language of the less threatening puny race. The first men adapted to their culture in order to secure mutually safe trade deals. I am not suggesting that the first men spoke another language. I believe they based much of the old tongue on old giant speak. In the days before the first men arrived at Westeros and the days before the children and giants lived in relative peace, except the occasional quarrel, I suggest that giants also migrated from Essos to Westeros. Jogwin is the Dothraki name for the stone giants. They were believed to reside in the mountains of Essos in Jaqua, the lands northeast to the Dothraki city Vaes Dothrak. Thank you, Ideas of Ice and Fire, for bringing this to my attention. Link in the description. They were said to be twice as large as the giants beyond the wall. Could it be that after eons of years of procreating with humans, they evolved to become slightly smaller but still cower over the common Westerosi?
I propose that they eventually migrated to Westeros and lived in harmony with the other human hybrid race, the children of the forest. This was for the mammoth culling and fruitful lands they would benefit from, like the Neanderthals of real history, who resided in Eurasia's wintry environment. The giants, however, didn't transform the environment, unlike humanity in both Westeros and in our own world, and unlike them, they did not destroy it. I also propose that the reasoning behind the near extinction of giants is due to their breeding with humans. Many men in Westeros and Essos seem abnormally large, such as the Mountain and Hodor, who's described as half the size of a real giant by Jon Snow. Perhaps similarly to the Neanderthals, their breeding with Homo sapiens could have been the reasoning behind their dwindling numbers. After all, we share at least 20% of our DNA with Neanderthals. Maybe the humans of the fantasy world, or at least the free folk, share a percentage of DNA with the Neanderthal equivalent, the giants. Children of the Forest also share this common sorrow that echoes throughout this series. Categorically, they are more aware of this than the giants or even the humans, and have been grieving from the loss of land since the beginning of humanity's place in Westeros, as they're the ones who were the first aggressors when the war started between the first men and the children of the forest.
Although I believe they are relatives to humankind, they are far more advanced and separate, evolutionarily and culturally speaking. They seem to share more visual features with trees and foliage than humankind, but this is their aesthetic. Just as this aesthetic has arisen from their environment, as too their eyes have evolved in the dark caves under the weirwood trees, as they have yellow eyes with slits in them to help see in the dark. They possess something that defines their evolutionary superiority, perhaps even more than our superiority to Neanderthals or a Westerosi to a giant. This is due to their communal psychic cognitive ability through the roots of the weirwood trees, as it absorbs consciousness, and the children who have died are bound to still be conscious in the network of trees. The children are well aware of this shared knowledge of humanity's crimes, and their consideration for the ecosystem outside of their initial region suggests a far less primitive humanoid, in fact futuristic. The weirwood network, alongside green seers, which allow one to perceive the world from an aerial perspective and see past future events, would wield a great deal of power. We know certain humans, like Bran Jojen and possibly the Ghost of High Heart, who possess the gift of green seeing. These powers seem only to be prophetic and not actually significant enough to change the course of our story, other than the paradoxes and double-edged swords that come from prophecy. Could it be that, like Bloodraven, Bran has been sent beyond the wall to connect his unbelievably strong powers of greenseeing to the Children of the Forest's collective mind, in order for them to construct a new kind of network consciousness? This could amplify the Children's collective hive-minded powers in the same way a perfect computer virus with a 0% chance of error or desolation could be a destructive force, as it would mutilate and transform into something that would affect all manner of technology through the human hive-minded network, the internet. In a sense, the virus would become immortal and would eventually transform into something non-biologically conscious and alive, much like all the dead children are not biologically alive but still real and influential. As the particular component of the White Walkers is winter, and the particular component of dragons is fire, it is evident that the particular element of the children is the forest, the trees, the critters, growling beasts and singing birds, the preservation of life. As we know all too well in our own world, from an evolutionary point of view, we decimate all other creatures on Earth. From a suffering point of view, neither animal nor mythical creature comes close to the destruction Homo sapiens create. I think George is trying to get this point across to us more than any other theme within A Song of Ice and Fire. Even the White Walkers seem to be destroying the forest with cold and darkness in reaction to humanity, and due to the dire times, the children have a plot to desolate humanity in the fourth devastating event, equivalent to the Hammer of Waters that broke the Arm of Dawn. I propose that the children were the entities who assisted both humanity and the giants with the construction of the wall to keep the White Walkers of legend at bay. It's the children's magic that is interwoven into the wall, and it is the children that orchestrated the doom of Valyria to break the spread of dark magic and fire, and overmining all the terrain, all in the name of our natural balance. I suggest the Children of the Forest will orchestrate one last devastating blow with the assistance of Bran's greenseer abilities, perhaps amplified with Jojen's flesh, a paste fed to Bran in a sort of ritual by the Children and Bloodraven, in the name of the forest and the ecosystem, not in the name of humanity and the breaking down of agriculture. What do I mean? How can farms have sent the children into a desperate plea of genocide? It turns out that the number one reasoning for deforestation in the Amazon rainforest is related to agriculture. It seems as if Westeros and Essos is at a peak of agricultural revolution. Slavery is a massive economic platform. It seems this has had a revolutionary effect on agriculture, as rather than hiring workers, a businessman could just buy a couple of slaves and use them to plow the field and break down the earth to make new crops such as wheat and grain. Most slaves worked in sugar plantations, and due to this, more sugar was transported to Britain, as sugar is addictive. The demand for sugar skyrocketed, just as I believe the agricultural revolution has skyrocketed in recent years in Westeros and Essos. Most slaves in our real world worked in sugar plantations. This straying of natural resources could have made the children react in unscrupulous ways, such as making a pact with the White Walkers to desolate humanity in return of free range in certain northern parts of Westeros, maybe north of the Wall. or maybe some sort of awakening of magic for humanity, so wars between humanity would bring the numbers down. They could have even made a pact with the Shrouded Lord related to the future spread of Great Ale, or the Drowned God or his followers such as Patchface or Euron to do their dirty deeds for them, or even all of the above to create a frenzy of subhuman warring with humans, and while all of this is happening, they stay in the cave and wait. Whatever this upcoming doomsday might be, I strongly doubt that it will be in any way to serve humanity. It will be to preserve the conservation of the ecosystem, and after the mess the humans will have left, the children will set out to reconstruct the world they once solely inhabited. White Walkers can cultivate certain regions beyond the wall, where it would be too cold and dead for things to grow and prevail. Giants like Neanderthals will live one with the natural world by taking no more than they need, or this would have been the case if they had not been scarcely wiped out. Whether Bran is being coerced or will become radicalised, I believe it will be through his sacrifice in front of a weirwood tree that the children will receive the uncompromising 0% error virus that will give leeway for the collective children's network to manipulate the minds of humans, white walkers, and gods to destroy each other. Out of this war-stricken economic and environmental disaster, the children will emerge from the dark caves under the weirwoods that they've existed in for so long that even their eyes have adjusted to the dark. The High Race possesses environmental and cultural harmony through their collective consciousness, and this will bring on a new era of prosperity. Of course, this is Game of Thrones. It is likely that a happy ending will not happen. I say this as I believe I have spotted a couple of fundamental errors in this plan. Firstly, I believe their collective consciousness is limited to mostly children of the forest, whose perception of humanity is rather limited. Human sacrifices, whose modern conception of the world is far less liberal than the children's, making the uninformed minds of these sacrifices, such as Maester Luwin's disbelief in the return of White Walkers, this will create dense issues in the collective minds of the children, whereas merging consciousness, no one person can bow for dominance. A pure network of 100 like-minded but individual children of the forest would create one clear goal that individual minds have been manipulated to form and work towards. Having one skeptical Maester Luwin in the mix taints the goals and directions of the children. Maybe this is why the First Men and the White Walkers sacrifice people and animals in front of the weirwood trees. Not to offer a gift to the gods, but to create a mishap within the weirwood network. Like some of the country's reactions of aggression to the extraterrestrials in Arrival, I believe that a similar reaction will happen to the children of the forest once they announce their existence and power to the modern world. I don't believe that there will be a positive outcome for the children, as even though they've been cautious, they still underestimate Homo sapiens. Humanity is too concerned with the sole preservation of ourselves. Any kind of threat in being second to a greater benevolent or intelligent creature will result in violent opposition, ultimately leading to their extinction. Just look at the Neanderthals and the last giant in A Song of Ice and Fire. It was not solely war that eradicated them into oblivion. It was our ignorance.